You don't need a whole lot of folk to get you prayers on.
Right. Amen.
All you need is what God put inside.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
You don't need no help. You already have the help. All you had to do is acknowledge that you had on your hands.
That's it.
So give my children a hand.
Amen. Amen.
All right, very good.
Thank God for this opportunity. At this time, we'll look at Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3. We begin at verses 5, and we're going to read verses 5 and 6. All right, see, I got it. If you don't, that's wrong. I'm supposed to have a smartphone, so it don't take long for them to find it.
All right now.
Some of us that old school, we like to go to the book.
Yeah, all right.
You remember when they didn't have smartphones.
All right.
We had to use the book. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. If you don't have your book, all with your neighbor.
All right.
Like I always say, if they can't share nothing else, we all be able to share the word of God.
That's right.
We all have it, say amen.
Amen.
And it reads, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways, somebody say all.
All.
Thy ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank and we praise you for this time, Lord God. We pray, Lord, always that you hide us behind the cross, and we will receive you. You will get the glory, you will get the honor, and you will get the praise. Out of everything that's said and done. Father God, give us receptive hearts, mind, and ears to hear your word. And not only be hearers, but we do it as well. Father God, bless this word to go out and accomplish that which you sent it out to accomplish. And it will not return void.
Yes.
Bless us now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to talk to you for a little while from the subject when the mess gets too thick.
All right.
Stir up the gift.
All right.
When the mess gets too thick, stir up the gift.
All right.
Many of you in here, which I know most of us men don't do it, so y'all ignore this part. And I ain't talking to you. But y'all ladies, they do it. I mean, I cook, so I can't, you know, put myself in that category because I cook a lot. But, you know, I'm cooking more than I used to cook, but I do cook. When you go to make a cake, or you go make cornbread, I didn't say eat it, I said make it. You go and you make it, and if you ever made gravy, how many of y'all know sometimes that gravy can get real thick on you if you don't do it like it needs to be done.
That's right.
So when it gets to be real thick, you got to do what? You got to add something to it.
Yeah.
And then what you got to do?
Stir.
You got to stir it.
Yeah.
And when it gets just like you need it to be, then everything is fine.
Amen.
Y'all know I'm a gravy connoisseur, so I know exactly how it's going to be made. If it don't look right, I'm going to let you know this ain't working.
All right.
Now try it again. It took me 20 some odd years to learn how to make gravy.
All right.
Wow. I was slow. 20-some-odd years, but I got it right. It was either going to be too thick or it was going to be too watery.
Mm-hmm.
But now, just right.
That's all right.
When the mess gets too thick, you got to add some stuff to it, and you got to stir it. You say, well, preacher, I really don't understand what you're saying. In your life, when stuff gets too thick,
yes,
it gets a little too hard for you to handle.
Yes.
You got to go to the source.
Yes.
You ever got, you know, when you get ready to cook, you have a recipe.
Yes.
If you don't follow the recipe, the food ain't going to turn out right.
That's right.
God gave us the recipe. All we got to do is follow. Yes. If we follow what he gives us, everything will turn out right. But when we don't do exactly what he tells us to do, that's when stuff starts getting out of the way. That means your life gets to be too thick because you'll start adding stuff that don't need to be there. A lot of us add folks in our life that ain't got no business being there. A lot of us add places in our life that we don't have no business going. A lot of us put a lot of stuff in our life that shouldn't be there. What happens? It starts to get thick. I believe one time I heard Danny say that you can't blame God for the mess. You just got to ask God to show you how to get out of the mess. Why? Because a lot of us created what? Our own mess. I know I'm talking to somebody in here. A lot of us created our own problems. A lot of us created our own struggles. We created our own issues. Why? Because we don't want to listen. We didn't want to follow direction. How many of y'all know when we were kids and growing up, we wanted to do just what we wanted to do? I can't figure out for the life of me that when we're young, we want to be old. When we're old, we want to be young. When we're young, when we're 13 and 14, we want to be 18 and 19. When we get to be 18 and 19, we want to be 20 and 25. I don't understand. And how many of y'all love Golden Girls like I do? Blanche was old. Right. But in her mind, she thought she was 38 years old. And everybody knew that Blanche was really old. You know, it doesn't make any sense. We're backwards. One time I tried to make a cake and I didn't have everything that needed. So I decided I was going to improvise. Didn't have no vegetable or mama. I rested in the refrigerator and got me some butter. Well, if I melt it down, it'll look the same. But it'll look the same. Melted it down, poured it in there. Got ready, you know you had to grieve the pain. Still, I ain't got no oil. I melted me a little bit more butter. Rub it around in there. Put the flour in there. And what happens when you don't use everything you're supposed to use? The cake came out hacking and heavy. When we don't follow God's rule, when we don't do it exactly like he tells us to, we will come out heavy. The reason why we're dealing with the heavy burdens that we're dealing with is because we're not following the plan that God has for each and every one of us. Why? I want to do what I want to do. And I've learned that when you try to do what you want to do, it doesn't always work out right. A lot of us, we got, like the prodigal son, we got that big head syndrome. And especially when we're around this age, we think we got it all figured out. Can't nobody tell us nothing. We think we got it all under control. And then we realize that when we get out of mom and dad's house, reality sets in. And you realize that when I was at home, the reason I thought I had it made because the way was already made for me. All I had to do was get up, get dressed, eat, sleep, go to school. That's all I had to do. But when I got out on my own and reality actually set in, I realized that there's some bills that got to be paid. I realized that there's a job that I got to go to in order to be able to pay the bills. And that's when stuff started really getting big. If you read the story of the prodigal son, when he finally got out on his own, that's when life started hitting.
That's right.
He got out with his friends. He thought he was able to do whatever he wanted to do. They went and partied. They did all they wanted to do. And when the money ran out, the friend ran out. That's when life started getting thick. And if you read on down in the book of Luke chapter 15, verses 17 and 19, is when he came to himself. And he realized, you know what? When I was at home, everything was great. Daddy had service, they took care of me, they fed me, they made sure I had everything I needed. But then I got crazy and wanted to leave home. And I said, give me what belongs to me. It's so funny to me when the children say, that's my money. But you don't work. That's mine. This my cell phone. You can't tell me what to do with it.
All right, Daddy.
Technically, I bought the cell phone.
Yeah.
I paid a bill on the cell phone. Yeah. Therefore, that means what? This my cell phone. Not your cell phone. This is God's body. He made it. He breathed breath into this body. He caused the eyes to open on this body. The ears to hear on this body. He called the mind to think on this body. Therefore, what? This is his body. Why? Because he made it. And so what that means, I have to do just what God wants me to do. When he came to himself, he said, I believe I'm going to get up and I'm going to go back home. Why? This message is getting to be too much for me. I can't handle all this. Have you ever got to a point in your life to where stuff just got too much for you to handle?
Oh, yes.
And this is our problem. This is our problem. Some of us in here love to run our mind. Now, you can get mad with me after it's over. It's all right. I got plenty of folk mad with me. Just get in line. We love to run our mind. And instead of going to God about our problems and the issues that we're having and the mess that we're in, because you got to understand, he made not only the body, but he made the spirit. So therefore, he understands already and he knows what's going on. Yes. So why don't you just go to the Creator?
That's it. That's it.
When your car messed up, where are you supposed to go? To a mechanic.
Yeah.
Stop getting out there, getting under the car, trying to think you know what you're doing. Trying to work on it. You have no mechanic experience. You don't know what you're doing, but you get out there and try to work on it. By the time you get it to bro half, he got more problems than you started out with in the beginning. Why? Because you're trying to fix it. Our biggest issue is we're trying to fix our own mess, our own problem, our own trouble, instead of taking them to God, allowing God to fix it, allowing God to work it out. We try to do it on our own. By the time we get it to God, you're more confused than what you was in the beginning. Why?
Right.
Because you tried to work it out on your own.
That's right.
You wonder why sometimes our children are doing some of the stuff that they're doing. It's because of the simple fact, we're trying to do stuff and we hadn't talked to God about it at all.
All right.
You have to realize, we were bad.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
Say it now.
Yes.
Now, let me rephrase that.
Yeah.
We were terrible when we were growing up. And we gave our mama and dad a whole lot of problems.
Yeah.
And the Bible said that man what reaps what he sowed. So therefore, you got to understand, when you plant it, it's coming up again. But when it comes up, it's 10 times worse than what it was when you put it out there. So you got to understand and know, while you sitting there grinning at your mama, I'm talking about you. I'm coming down your street. The thing is, you got to understand and know that that's where it comes in. The thing that you did to mama and daddy, if you sit back and look at it, your children doing the same thing. You know? It's just a whole lot worse. It just got real thick now. See, it was a little thick to you back then because they were tearing your behind up. But now, since you're the one that's got to give the whoopings out, and the children are the ones that are doing the acting up, it done got real thick to you now. Now you scratching your head trying to figure out, what am I going to do about this child?
Right now.
They don't listen. They don't do what they're told to do. I don't even want to take them nowhere because of the way they act. Y'all know I'm right about it. And so now you're scratching your head trying to figure it out. And we take them to this place to get them help. We take them over there. We'll take them to Auntie Miss Donahue. We'll take them over there to Auntie this person. We take them to Uncle over here trying to get them help. When all you got to do is just pray. All you got to do is pray about it. Now, Lord, you gave this child to me. I don't know what to do with him. But I'm laying them at your feet. Some of us don't spend enough time praying with our children, not only with them, but praying for them. When they leave that house every day, you can't be with them 24 hours a day. You can't watch over them every step they make, everywhere they go. You can't do that. So you got to put them in God's hands. The prodigal son realized, if I get up and go back home, I can get this straightened out. Some of us don't want to get up, and we don't want to go back home. Brad, what you mean? A lot of us like mess.
All right now.
Some of us love keeping up mess.
Yes.
You know how you tell when you're around a messy person? They always got something to say. or as the kids say, they're throwing shade. you know, we got to make sure they understand what we're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, they call it throwing shade. What else y'all call it? I ain't funny now. But they talk about throwing shade on each other. I never could understand what that meant. And still don't really understand. But the fact of the matter is, you tell when you're around a messy person, they always got something to say. They always talking about somebody. They always talking about somebody's business. And what somebody doing, what they ain't doing, what they should be doing, you can tell when you're around somebody like them.
Yes.
So what I've learned to do when it comes to messy folk, back up out the way. I'm going to let you be messy by yourself. Because when that stuff gets thick, I can't do nothing for you. I can't help you. Because it don't get back that you run in your mind. It got real thick for him. I can imagine his friends were talking about him and said, now he broke. He ain't got no money. He can't party with him no more. But, you know, whenever they would go out, they would go to the club. He would want by himself and everything. He would say, drinks on me, everybody over here. So everybody, half the folks in the club was all the way around him. Now, he don't do that no more. And he's all by himself. Stick a pin right there. When you look at 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses 1 through 8, you look at David. David had just come back from battle. They get back home, and their house is destroyed. Everything is messed up. The women and the children are gone. And by that time, the men that David was with, they got upset with David. David did the only thing he knew how to do. This is a situation that I can't fix. David said, I got to stir up what's inside of me. David went over to a little corner all by himself. And he began to seek the Lord. He said, Lord, now what should I do about this situation? He said, because I can't make a move without you. Our other biggest problem is we move before we get the answer.
All right, all right.
Before we wait on God to tell us what we need to know, we start trying to move on our own.
Yeah.
And just imagine what would have happened if David had a move on his own. He'd have never won the victory. When you move when God tells you to move, the victory will come.
It will.
But when you move on your own, more mess keep on coming. So David sought the Lord. The Lord told him, said, pursue, overtake, and recover everything that belongs to you.
All
right, man. The thing is, if I learn to listen to God, no matter how thick my mess is, He'll thin it out for me. No matter how dark it may be. You remember the last time I stood in, I told you that when it's dark, all you got to do is stay calm. Be still and wait on God. A lot of us don't know how to be calm. We get hysterical when problems come. When the bill comes in the mail and it's $2,000, but your bank account only says $500, we get hysterical. Instead of calling on God. Why? Because he said he owns a cattle on a thousand hills. Anything and everything I need, God will supply. Why get upset about it? Put it in his hand. But when it's dark, just be calm. Be still. Why? He knows exactly where you are. It might be dark to you, but it ain't dark to him. He can see you wherever you are. He knows exactly what's going on, not only in you, but around you. He knows exactly what the problem is. And if you stand still long enough and just call on him, and if you keep calling on him, I promise you he'll hear you. Not only will he hear you, way out of while you feel a little tap on your shoulder to let you know what everything is going to be all right. I'm coming to your rescue. If we go on just a little bit further, and I'm going to get out your way. Isaiah chapter 38, verses 1 through 7. dealing with a man by the name of Hezekiah. Hezekiah got some bad news. Prophet told Hezekiah, you're going to die. Hezekiah got a little discouraged. And I need you to understand, it's okay to get discouraged.
Yeah.
We're going to do that. Why? We're human. Uh-huh. None of us in here are perfect. We're going to get discouraged sometimes. Yeah. That's okay. But don't fall off. Try.
All right.
A lot of us get discouraged and then we want to give up. Don't give up in your mess. Keep on pushing.
All right,
I love the story about that old goat that fell down in that well. Uh-huh. The main important part of that story is the goat never gave up.
That's right.
Oh, 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 I know in life folk gonna throw dirt on top of you.
Right,
folk gonna talk about you.
Yeah.
They gonna put you down. They gonna do all kinds of stuff to you. You gonna go through a whole lot in life.
Yeah.
The lights may get cut off. The water may get cut off. They may fire you at work. The children gonna act up. Your husband ain't gonna do right. You gonna go through a whole lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. But what I love about that old goat, he just shook it off and packed it up. And you know what? I've learned that your troubles and your trials will help strengthen you on your journey.
Yeah.
If you just keep on holding on to God's unchanging hand, your problems will turn into your prayer. Your tribulations will turn into your testimony.
Yeah.
All you got to do is what? Just keep shaking it off.
Yeah.
Keep calling on it. And I promise you, He'll work it out for you. And the thing is, every round gets what?
Higher.
So the more stuff that goat put under his feet, the higher he got.
Yeah.
I need you to understand, the more stuff that the people throw on you and you shake off, the higher God gonna move you up. You're gonna have to go through some levels of some trials. You're gonna go through levels of temptation. You're gonna go through levels of pain. But the more you keep calling on God,
He's
gonna make you go higher and higher. Anybody here want to go higher?
Yeah.
I don't care what the devil throws at you, but I want to go higher in the Lord. I don't care how terrible my problems may be, I'm trying to go higher in the Lord.
Yeah.
Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and he began to talk to the Lord. And a lot of people have came to me and said, Red, how do you pray? How do you go to God in prayer? How do you talk to him? I talk to him just like I'm talking to you.
All right.
Every time I'm out, hey, Lord, you know I'm down here. You know what I'm dealing with. Mm-hmm. You know what the problem is.
Yes.
Oh, yes. I know you want me to come to you, so that's why I'm doing it. Mm-hmm. I said, Lord, now you know, these folks at work really getting on my nerves. They saying this, they saying that. I'm getting tired. Anybody ain't getting tired of something?
Oh,
tired?
Yeah.
I thought I would never get it. Lord, these children just don't want to act right. They can pick up the phone and play video games. They can pick up the phone and get on Instagram. They can do all the kind of stuff, but they can't pick up the phone and say, hey, how you doing? Y'all don't hear me. They can't pick up the phone and text and say, Dad, I just want to check on you. Mom, I just want to see how you doing.
Yeah.
Lord, these children didn't get on my nerve. And then sometimes, we, you know, for us that really got a close relationship with God, we really get comfortable with it. And the glove didn't come off. Look at him. The big-headed, box-headed, bad, crazy, ignorant children really getting on my nerves. The Lord's like, okay, I'm going to wait till you get finished. Because there was a time when you was crazy, big-headed, box-headed, pig-headed, didn't understand, didn't want to do right. So the same thing you telling me about you, your mom and dad told me the same thing a long time ago.
That's right.
So,
right now.
Y'all know what I'm right. So we talked to him just like we having a conversation with each other. Mm-hmm. You've been riding down the road and stuff that really weighing heavy on you.
Oh, yeah.
I've gotten to the point that I don't care about folk that pass by me. I don't care if you're talking to yourself. So what?
All right.
At the end of the day, talking to you ain't going to do me no good.
Yeah.
So if I got to talk to him and it look like I'm talking to myself, that's fine. I don't care what you think about it. I'm talking to somebody I know that can help me through what I'm dealing with. Every time I'm riding down the road, I just start talking, Lord, it's here. My heart is here. Lord, I need to know what my next move needs to be. I don't want to move without you now. Because I know if I move without you, coming back is the worst thing to do.
Yeah, there is.
When you make a move that you ain't supposed to make and you got to backtrack,
yes.
That's a hard thing to do.
Yes.
So Lord, I don't want to make a move without you.
Alright.
So it's okay to talk to him. That's how you get through the mess. You got to talk to God about it. But when you say, well, Reverend, I don't understand the part when you say, stir up the guilt. Well, when I go to talking to God, God does what? He encourages me.
Yes.
To be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in his word, in his will, always doing just what he wants me to do. Turn to Psalms chapter 34. Believe it or not, I'm finna get out of here. Some of y'all looking at me kind of crazy and don't understand what's going on. But I'm trying to help not only you, but I'm trying to help myself.
All right.
Because we all need encouragement, am I right?
Amen.
In Psalm 34, verses 1 through 8, I'm not going to read all of it, but the first verse says, I will bless the Lord at all times.
Yeah.
His praises shall continually be in my mouth.
Yeah.
Number 2 says, my soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad.
Yeah.
If you can't do nothing else with me, because I know you can't help me through my problem. You can't help me through what I'm dealing with. But look at verse 3. If you can't do nothing else with me, can you do this? Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt his name together. So if you can't do nothing else for me, let's praise him together. If we can't do nothing else for each other, let's lift up the name of Jesus with each other. Why? Because I don't know what you're going through. You don't know what I'm going through. But the old saying says that praises go up, the blessings come down now. So if we begin to praise him together, all of us can come through what we're dealing with. Oh, magnify him with me. And then go down, I love verse 8. Says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Yes.
Blessed is the man that trusts in him.
Uh-huh.
When it gets through.